I'm working on being a little bit more mellow about, you know, things that happen in my life. It's really hard because the habits you develop over, I've been a certain way my whole life, and I'm at a place where I want to make a lot of changes, you know, whether it's, you know, career changes, whether it's friendships, whether it's family, whether it's drama, whether it's whatever it's thrown my way. I'm trying to look at it a lot different now, because no matter what, those things are going to be there. It's just how you react to it. But it's hard going through those changes, like slowing down. I don't know how to do it. So every day that I catch myself kind of being the old version of myself, I have to like stop and be like, hey, snap out of it. Remember, you're doing that thing again.
I always relate life to being like a game, and there's like micro levels within a game and stuff. Like, okay, there's the bigger picture, right? Where you have to like defeat the main boss at the end of the game, right? But during the little journey or the game that you're in, there's these like small levels that you have to surpass, right? Like think of it like Mario, right? You gotta jump over this guy, you gotta jump over the pit of, obstacles, right? Because you're not only trying to finish the game, there are still obstacles that are in your way that you have to progress. It's life is all about progression, and I'm addicted to that.
Situations happen in moments in our lives. People enter our lives for moments and periods of our life that were just meant to happen at that moment or during that stage of our life. It won't always be consistent. And I think that's the one thing moving forward in every new year, God willing, you know, besides my health and happiness and my family, is that I just want to always have that progression, but also have a healthy perspective on situations, understanding that a lot is out of our control.
Yeah. I want to do something different. I kind of want to become my own identity all over again, but this new identity, this much more, I would say, mature, grown version of myself, but I want to get myself uncomfortable.
What's good, everybody? Welcome back to the Demo Podcast. It's Neela.
And it is Adis. What's up, family?
What's up, Mo?
What's good, Mojo?
Hi, you guys.
Today, it's been a minute, eh?
Today, I found out what happens scientifically to the body when your foot falls asleep or your hands fall asleep.
Blood doesn't rush to it? You Googled it?
No. Your nerves are compressed and it's not connecting to your brain. And so that's why they're feeling, yeah. So basically that's why the tingling sensation happens. Me and Mo were driving today. We were coming back from somewhere and I was sitting like crisscross applesauce on the passenger seat. And obviously it happens when you're in the same position for a long amount of time. And I was putting pressure on my feet sitting that way. And I was like, oh God, my foot fell asleep. And you know when sometimes it's painfully asleep, like it's like stabbing and I keep having to move it and I'm like moving up and down, and I was like, I want to figure out the science behind what happens when this is happening. So I Googled it, and just in case anyone needs to know, it's because you're putting compression on your nervous system and it's not contacting your brain or something, and it's called like paresthesia, and that's what happens.
The whole time I thought it was just blood not rushing into your
system
or whatever, you know?
No, you're just pressing your nerves too much. That's too much pressure in one
human
spot.
Body.
In case anyone needs to know.
Mojo, what's new?
Nothing much, you guys. How's it going? I think the last time I was here was last year.
Was it last year?
It was a very long time ago.
Had to have been.
And here we are, a month away from 2024.
How do you guys feel about the new year coming in? Every time you blink, it's the new year.
I know.
I'm thinking about the last time we were in studio in Halloween. Remember before we had the Halloween episode? And I could not believe, because I went in and I saw our older Halloween episodes. And I was like, a year flew by again. And I'm like witnessing like every season, every year that changes, I'm in a completely different area, new people, new friend. It's weird.
I find really?
I find myself like not new friend groups, new people, just like new job, like it's just a new setting, and I'm just so interested to see when 2024 ends, inshallah, like where am I going to be in 2025? How am I going to be feeling? Am I going to be in a good mental space, in a good headspace? Am I going to be filled with love? Is there going to be like what hardships are going to pass? Hopefully not a lot, you know, what changes are going to happen? It's just very interesting seeing the world kind of like
Fly past you, bro. Yeah, that's crazy because I was thinking about the same thing. I remember obviously right before quarantine, COVID, every time I go back to that time, I'm like, how the hell did we get here? Did we really lose those 3 years? Because when you refer to the past, you either refer to COVID or you refer to the time before it. There's like no in between. But now that you think about it,
time is ridiculously flying by. And it's actually funny that you say that, Mo, because when I think of you on the podcast, I only think about that quarantine era because we were all at home stuck and she would drive me to the podcast every other day and we would record. And you had that's when we had like momentum with Mo. She was on so many episodes back to back. But it's because I'd make her drive me here and I'd be like, yo, just get on the pod. But
I remember Mojo sitting in this seat. She was doing the switcher and everything.
Yeah. You guys fired me so quick. I didn't think I did that bad.
I'd be like this.
I probably had just smoked before.
I used to be talking and the switcher would be on the ceiling.
Bro, the thing is, it's crazy to see the progression also of like where our lives have taken us. You know, even like you look back into previous episodes, episode 80, remember I sent it to you and stuff? And where we were then and where we are now.
And how I looked then and how I look now.
Oh my God.
She recently was like,
I did a side by side of her video in like 2021, maybe 2022.
Yeah.
And then I did one from like a month ago.
Insane.
Dude.
The one I sent you. And the thing is, everyone keeps saying like, when did you look like that? And I was like, hey, you've always seen me for me. Like I was in there.
I mean, that.
I was unhealthy.
And also you start to implement different workout regimens.
Lifestyle. Yeah. And it's funny that you say that. Sorry. Going back to your initial point on where your life is going to be, like where a year from now, and so much can change in a year. I think this year for me, in my first year in my 30s, I've came across the most change, and it's like been kind of, it's been impactful in a way where my life has had to change, but it's been okay. And we've talked about this before. It's like no matter what happens, what comes our way, regardless of what we have planned for ourselves, the universe will always play its part on like bringing negativity, bringing high highs, low lows, happy moments, sad moments. We just had recently, you know, we have moments where life shows us just how short it is. And like with that, I think beyond what it is going to be, we can only focus on like what we can contribute towards the growth of our lives and how we can control that. And the reality is that no matter what, it always plays out and is okay. You know, we always have some sort of resilience that plays out in the right way.
That's why I don't like making drastic decisions and jumping to conclusions when something really is affecting me like negatively or I'm sad about something. I don't like jumping and making like a super rational decision because I know life is all about the waves. You have to learn how to ride the waves. Some waves are going to be smaller and you ride it out and it's very easy to get you to shore. And some waves are going to be scary and gigantic and you have to learn how to kind of, you know, weather the storm. I've seen so many people when they're going through moments of triumph or times are just like, you know, not kind of on the side of like things being good and happy, they make a drastic decision, whether it be at work, whether it be at a life decision. And then once the storm kind of clears, they're left with the decision that they made, you know, in that very moment that, you know, didn't have to be like that crazy. You know what I mean? Yeah. I've learned that. Like, I'm getting more comfortable knowing that there's going to be bad times, there are going to be good times. Just ride the wave. And just be a cruiser, be a chiller, you know what I mean? And it made me so much more comfortable going through that bad. And hopefully it's because that bad wasn't so bad, you know what I mean? Because then I could say it right now and then God forbid something tragic happening because life kind of happens. And then me being like, all right, I got to make a drastic decision. So this is probably a moment of privilege, to say the least, how I feel right now. You know what I mean?
I can say I was definitely like that, and I'm working on being a little bit more mellow about, you know, things that happen in my life. It's really hard because the habits you develop over, I've been a certain way my whole life, and I'm at a place where I want to make a lot of changes, you know, whether it's, you know, career changes, whether it's friendships, whether it's family, whether it's drama, whether it's whatever it's thrown my way, I'm trying to look at it a lot different now because no matter what, those things are going to be there. It's just how you react to it. But it's hard going through those changes, like slowing down. I don't know how to do it. So every day that I catch myself kind of being the old version of myself, I have to like stop and be like, hey, snap out of it. Remember, you're doing that thing again. And luckily, I have like my sisters and the close people in my life that call me out on those things, which I'm grateful because now I really know Like, if somebody's in your ear telling you over and over again, like, hey, you don't like that version of yourself, don't do it. It can be a little harsh sometimes. It can be, you know, the nicest way, but those things help. So if you're going through the notion of trying to change yourself, definitely it's hard, but it's very rewarding because you become so much lighter. You know, you exhale people in your life that you thought were everything to you, but, you know, you come to grow out of being in their lives and you realize so many things outside of, you know, just those little things alone. I don't know. It's nice. If you're on that path, then all the best to you. It's going to be nice.
And I always relate life to being like a game, and there's like micro levels within a game and stuff. Like, okay, there's the bigger picture, right? Where you have to like defeat the main boss at the end of the game, right? But during the little journey or the game that you're in, there's these like small levels that you have to surpass, right? Like think of it like Mario, right? You got to jump over this guy, you got to jump over the pit of, the little obstacles, right? Because you're not only trying to finish the game, there are still obstacles that are in your way that you have to progress. It's all, life is all about progression, and I'm addicted to that, right? And there's like little micro things that you go through in life. Like these are macro, right? Micro stuff like learning to be composed in moments of trial, right? Like if you're going through like a difficult conversation and like sometimes you want to lash out at somebody, sometimes you just want to let loose and be like, you know what, like I don't deserve this type of treatment, this is how I'm gonna go about it. I'm about to pop off, right? But sometimes you have to control it, right? Because like it will ruin your progression if you do decide to like take that step, and that step is sometimes will take you 3 or 4 steps back, right? Yeah. So I'm like addicted to the progress. Yeah. Like I want to be the best version of myself year after year, and with the new year I'm starting to learn like there's a big question mark of what I'm going to go through and the good that's going to come and the bad that's going to come. And it's like, I'm hoping that it's going to be all for the best and there's going to be good things. But I hope when on the other side of 2024, I come in, you know, with just minor little scrapes, but big dubs, you know what I mean? Like big W's.
Yeah. I think life is about progression, but for me lately more than ever, I think it's become a lot about perspective. And I say this because I take any situation and I could look at it being either one way or another. I can go somewhere with a friend and focus on everything that didn't go my way, or I can focus on it and shift the perspective and be like, okay, I went out, I enjoyed time with a friend and like it was a good time and whatever if things didn't go as planned, you know? And that shifts your mentality in so many ways too. I mean, you know, right now, I know like there's so many things that I complain to you about. I'll talk about like if I'm like talking to people and I'm just like, oh, this didn't happen. But it's like I'm allowing that to become my perception of the situation when I can also look at it for something positive, and that can shift the situation too. So I think that life does such a good job at making us pivot or making us stop, making us change the plan, making us go backwards, move forward faster. Life is something that we can't control. So all we can do is control our intake on it and our vision moving forward based off of how we want to look at the situation. And I think that's drastically helped me. And I think that's a growth thing. Mori said this earlier, made a huge point on, me and her talk a lot about recently more than ever, protecting your peace. Like she'll call me, we'll complain about something else. I'll be like, Mo, protect your peace, focus on you. And vice versa, she'll tell me like, listen, not your problem. And I think it's really helped us in a sense for our own sanity. But it's like, situations happen in moments in our lives. People enter our lives for moments and periods of our life that were just meant to happen at that moment or during that stage of our life. It won't always be consistent. And I think that's the one thing moving forward in every new year, God willing, you know, besides my health and happiness and my family, is that I just want to always have that progression, but also have a healthy perspective on situations, understanding that a lot is out of our control, but also trying to look everything. And I've always done this, try to look at the good, even if it's been a horrible situation, just for what it is, you know, because that only helps you move forward with the idea of the unknown and what's to come.
The thing is, like, life is always changing, like we said, like earlier, back to this like main topic of like just by the years. And it's like, for me, I'm in this weird state of like welcoming change and wanting to change my routine. And like, as stupid as like
going to- Yeah, you call me the other and you're like, yo, I'm feeling like I need to do some like, what did you say?
What?
You're like, I need to do some wild right now, like I'm gonna go take a Barry's class.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Dumb as like changing a workout or doing another routine, like I'm welcoming change because I know change is inevitable. So like before, we all want to be comfortable, right? We go back to our comfort zone, whether it be going to our families, our parents, or whatever it is, right? Your mom, and you just want to just chill, and like that is your comfort area where that is not really changing, and you could just be yourself. And when you try to shy away from like what's what reality is and how reality is just always changing, I think like you, that can bring a sense of like, it's intimidating because then you're letting life, instead of taking the bull by the reins and like controlling the change, you're letting life kind of change you and control you. Now I'm like changing my perspective. I'm like, look, like I'm going to welcome change because it's likely going to happen, whether it be in my friend group, my relationship, my workplace, whatever, change is going to happen. So now instead of shying away from it and going back to what I'm comfortable with, even as dumb as working out comfortably and not going through, you know, stresses of like running 4 miles and then doing this, like everything, I'm totally okay with change because I know it's coming. So now that I know it's coming, let's go.
Well, I want to know, are you in a place where you want to challenge, like you want to place yourself in a situation where you're challenging yourself?
Yeah.
See, I need to get over that little hump because I'm there. But I'm not there. Yeah. I want to do something different. I kind of want to become my own identity all over again. But this new identity, this much more, I would say, mature, grown version of myself. But I want to get myself uncomfortable. How the hell do I do that?
It's here's
you do
thing.
Something you've never done before.
So yeah. Jump out of a plane.
And yeah, I mean, it could be.
Maybe not for me.
Maybe start with Orange Theory.
But here's the thing.
No, you've been like, I want to do some habit, right?
I want to develop a new routine. And
it's comfort.
I just will wear my same sweater every day and I don't care.
Here's
if
the
people
thing.
Notice.
I like to cut mine, but she wants to cut the one that I wear every day.
Look, I've noticed this, okay? And I can speak for myself, right? For example, like I want to explore entrepreneurship with Neela, right? Like you and I have this makeup brand, right? And like with the makeup brand, you have to buy these brushes, right? And the brushes are gonna cost you about $200,000, right? Let's just say for example, right? For product placement, packaging. Marketing, getting in, the
packaging.
Prototypes, packaging, everything. It's gonna cost $200,000, right? But I love my lifestyle right now. I want a Lambo. I want a nice car to drive every single day, right? Like I want to, this life that I'm living right now is just very comfortable for me. I have a nice car. I drive to the gym. I have a routine, right? But I don't want to give up that comfort to explore this possibility that is a big question mark.
Then sell a watch.
I'm scared. No, that's what I'm saying.
Sell
but
a
I don't,
watch.
But that's the thing. I don't want to because that watch is like something that I love and I'm comfortable in it. It's like this, you don't know what's on the other side of that hill, but you do know what's on this side of the hill. And this side makes you happy. It's comfortable. It's like, you know, so it's like getting over that, like, that feeling of like being nervous and scared of going up that hill because you don't have the proper, you don't know if you have the right harness and you don't know how to get up there. But on the other side of that could be so much more greatness, whether that's exploring a new job opportunity. You're like, damn, like, I don't know what it's like becoming a lawyer because they just got rid of the bar exam, by the way. I don't know if you heard
that. Is that why Diddy settled so fast?
Oh, bro, don't even get me there. Did you hear
that?
That
was so weird.
I know.
Yeah, I mean,
but you know what? I'm not surprised. You go back and you see some of the interviews and like the body language and how uncomfortable he was. And
I was thrown off by like the drug addiction. She had to go to rehab and stuff. Like my heart breaks for her if that was really what it was.
So for a lot of people that don't know at home, I guess Cassie filed a civil lawsuit against P. Diddy, Sean Diddy Combs, basically stating that he... human her, abused her, mentally abused her, forced her to take drugs, forced her to have with multitudes of guys at these thing called FOs or something like that, where it would be just like he would invite a bunch of male and he would watch them have with Cassie, and that caused her a lot of emotional damage.
That's terrifying.
And it was a civil lawsuit, so it was different than other lawsuits where he wouldn't go to jail, right? Like, it's not for him to go to jail. It's for him to cough up money. He's a billionaire, so she wanted to get money out of it. Again, for emotional damage. Like, you never know how much, you know, like, there's no amount of money that can put someone at ease from going through something like an R word, right? Or going through something like getting abused or getting physically abused by a man or a woman, if you're a man. That sort of thing happens. But for me, like... that is so outside of the reality that I understand, and like putting a hands on your girl or like wanting to harm your girl or put her through anything. So I'm like, I thought it would be different. Go get money and put the guy in jail. And because like, then how is he going to learn? He could just write a check and then move on. But I think the reason what they're saying is, sorry to cut you off, Mojo, but what he's doing and why he settled in 24 hours is because he didn't want, and I watched Academics stream on it, and what Academics also talked about is he didn't want to go through the embarrassing depositions, right? Because in a deposition, like the Amber Heard, Johnny Depp, they ask you anything, and they're like, okay, did you force her to have with 10 different guys while you watched? Mm-hmm. And then people are going to be like, bro, what? Cancel this dude. Like, what is he doing? It's on some R. Kelly, right? And then also, what if other girls come out, right? Like, like J-Lo and these other people, like, yeah, bro, he's a predator, right? And then, like, I heard that, like, P. Diddy's ex-baby mama who passed away.
Kim Porter.
Yeah, exactly.
May she rest in peace.
May she rest in peace.
That was a little weird, too.
She was going to come out with a tell-all book.
Yeah, that's why. And she suddenly had a heart attack, I think. But there was
foul play, people were saying, that were like possibly, and I don't know about that. I didn't read too much into it, but it's insane that like behind closed doors, you never know what people are going through. That's why like with my family, when I talk to you and when I talk to Mo and I talk to like the girls in my family, I know to not like overstep my boundaries, right? Because like at the end of the day, you guys are human beings and you guys are going to love who you love and you guys are going to go through experiences that every human is going to go through. Just like if I have an experience with a girl who treats me wrong and does me wrong, like, although you'll have, like, from a girl's perspective, everything to tell me, I'm going to experience what I have to experience in order for me to grow within that and to learn by my own means, right? But, like, it's just scary to me that I don't know what the women in my family and the girls that I'm friends with or whatever that they're going through. But if you're ever going through a situation that gives you those red flags, it's you have to trust your gut. I don't know, because like I have a soft spot for women because like I know the dynamic between a man and a woman. And when it comes to physical stuff, like not on some misogynistic, like a man can do damage to a girl, bro. Like we have to protect our women in society. You know what I mean? And it's like hella crazy that I can walk past or girls like at the mall or like, you know, on the day to day or even my own family members where I go and see them on Thanksgiving and I see them on holiday events. And I have no idea the trauma that they're going through in their household with their partner or whatever. And it scares me because sometimes it's too late for girls, right? They become in this relationship where they're so codependent on their husband or they don't work a job and they're depending on this guy to provide for their families or they don't know what it means to go get a lawyer even or they don't even have enough money to go get a lawyer to get a divorce. It scares me so much. And when I read that, I'm like, holy bro. Upon first glance, I thought they were like cool. Like, oh, they were like a power couple. Like, Diddy's this billionaire. She's a gorgeous model. You would never expect it. And then when you peel back the layers, I'm just like, who else? I hope anybody that I know is not going through this, which likely, if I'm a percentage guy, there probably is very weird dynamics of relationships and marriages that are like this. And it scares me. It scares me for the girls that I know and girls that I don't know, you know?
There's a lot. I think with that industry, it's really just the power of money and, you know, fame and all of these things and these non-disclosures and all of these things that even if people were to say it, others won't believe it because you have such a following or people never want to believe it. But I think with those people in that industry, it's very common. They get away with a lot of stuff and they get to shut them up with money. Money silences everybody. Did I say that right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I'm wondering why maybe now she decided to come out with this. I mean, they have been apart for a minute. Granted, she had babies. She got married. I'm sure she's trying to protect her children and all those things. He also came out with a video immediately I saw on TikTok where he's just like, follow the light. Don't fall into the darkness. Like, I'm sticking to the light. I'm not going to let this pull me down, blah, blah, blah.
Brother love.
People in the comments are just like, what happens in the dark comes to light and like count your days, blah, blah, blah. It's sad to understand these things as human beings to know the nature of what goes on behind closed doors, to your point, you know, at the end of the day, whether it's Diddy, whether it's Cassie, they're human beings. So it's kind of like to know that people are treating people this way is just messed up. For me, it took a toll because I also understand what it's like to be blind in love with someone. And in some part of you see this as okay because you love that person. And I also know that like you make excuses for the people that you love, or like, yeah, the relationship is more important than the way you're feeling in that moment. And so you don't want to jeopardize. I mean, and vice versa. It's not just man on woman, woman on men too. Like they can have that control, bring those insecurities where you feel like you literally can't be with anyone else. And what would your life be if you left this person? So like, okay, beat me to death. It's fine. I'm still here. Because in a weird way, like, because a lot of people are arguing like, well, she stood through it. But it's like, yes, but in a lot of case scenarios, it is hard to walk away, especially if you're in the public light and stuff, right? Like reputations are on the table, and it's like, it is hard when your feelings are involved. You literally can't see. And granted, it was probably also hard if you're under like that type of control to walk away. But like, I think, you know, what it sometimes does take is like in her case scenario, another man to come sweep you off your feet, to literally remove you from the situation where that, you know, like gone. We don't know what that really looked like. He didn't just come up, show up. That was her trainer and they got married. It's like, we don't know how maybe did he, how toxic he made it, you know, like what the drama was there. But sometimes it takes that depth to really like someone else to really pull you out of it. And it's, that's what's necessary. But it's sad that, and to most point, I do see, and it's not just men and fame. I think men with money and power to some degree,
men and that, women, that it's not
masculine,
just men.
Yeah, that masculine toughness, energy, it comes, that bracket comes with the sense of control. I can imagine where your accessibility is unlimited and you can have anything you want. Maybe drugs are involved. Who knows if Diddy was on drugs? Like that type of makes you crazy. And it's like, to most point, when you can silence anything, it's like you can get away with anything. So it's like, I think it happens more so than often. I think about, and now when I see the videos, I can't unsee it. When I see Diddy, I'm like, he looks like he beats her behind closed doors, you know? And it's like, sad. And then there was this Madea movie. Shout out Madea, always makes the best movies. Tyler Perry. But what was it, Diary of a Mad Black Woman or something like that, where her husband's like beating her and yeah, like she, and behind, he's like this multi-millionaire and like, you know, they look so happy, perfect couple, and like behind closed doors he's like literally beating her. And it's just so sad that this is, you know, the reality that a lot of people do live in. You'll never know.
The thing is like, it's that cliche quote, it's like love is blind, right? Because at the time, like, love is such a strong emotion when you love somebody, because like you are always constantly looking for the potential of what they could be. When you're in love with someone, you're obviously in love with the best parts of that person, right? And those best parts could feel so good, and they can yeah, bring these emotions that you never even knew you had within yourself.
Even if it's
before,
only 10% of that person, and the other 90s, exactly. I know, I've been there.
Because it outweighs that other 90%, right? Mm-hmm. Because you're always thinking through the lens of what this love could potentially become or be. And unfortunately, sometimes that never comes to fruition. Like, it's just going to be this redundant pattern or cycle, because it's very difficult to change people. And even though you want that change for them because they could amount to so much more than they are right now, and you want to have this idea that everybody wants to be their best selves, right? They want to put their best foot forward and they want to progress. Like we were just talking about progression and progression in life and stuff. But unfortunately, some people don't have that. And it's so crazy when you meet people, you're meeting their bad qualities. You're meeting their, the stuff that they do behind the scenes that you would never understand until you really get to know that person. It's so crazy when I'm meeting people, I'm like, what are you hiding, my guy?
Right.
Like, what we are you, secrets. What are your worst traits that right now, you know, there's this term all over TikTok, they say love bombing, when people love bomb you at first.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's like a normal thing when it comes to dating someone initially, right? Like, we talked about relationships.
I've fully been love bombed.
Yeah.
Fully.
Like,
fully.
Let's say, for example, you're going on a date with a guy. That guy is going to be like, okay, Neela, I'm going to pay for the bill right now. I'm going to open your door for you. I'm going to do this for you. I'm going to do that for you.
He's on his best behavior.
Exactly, right?
It's the first impression or the second or the third. So they're going to be on their best behavior.
Yes.
They're going to do everything that they know girls love. And then guess what? Love bombed.
And unfortunately, that's the thing though.
Yeah,
unfortunately,
crazy.
It might not be as sadistic and as creepy as love bombing the definition is, because that guy, when you're like, I'm not a love bomber, but also like when you're first meeting someone, it's exciting, right? It's like, I'm first meeting someone, I want to put my best foot forward. I want to be like, and then after 7-8 years with this girl, sometimes you might not open the door for her, right? That's like normal,
no,
right?
No, that's not love bombing. Like, that's like a relationship. That's
like you get comfortable
prolonged
and stuff.
Yeah, that's normal.
But there
like
also is the extreme extreme side where you're actually manipulating this girl, sociopathic narcissist, like where you start to see that. And that's hella scary, right? Like you would never be able to tell in the first year. And then you're spending your life with this person. Yeah. You're exchanging every deepest, darkest secret with this person. Then they use it against you. And then like you have that with normal day-to-day people, right? Like people that work regular jobs. Like imagine this on a level where you have everything at your disposal, every asset, every type of money, everything, security, people that do PR for you, marketing for you, their level of what they now brings them happiness. It's like a billionaire, right? A billionaire is not going to give a fuck about buying a Ferrari. Mm-hmm. That's like petty, right? It's like regular degular. Over time, that level of obsession with wanting more, whether it be on a materialistic base or a sexual deviant kind of space, like with Diddy and wanting all these guys to like.
That's weird.
It's like,
did he confess any of that? Did he admit or he just settled? So no, like, what does settling mean?
So when they settled, when the lawyer came out with their statement, it said that my, what is that called? My, what is that called? Like when you're the lawyer, you're.
Client.
Yeah. Your client, my client does not admit to any of this. We're just settling, you know.
Jeez, do we know how much?
At first it was 30 to 40 million, but I'm sure it's higher now.
Yeah, it has to be, I think.
To settle like this.
Damn, that's the quickest settlement ever.
Call an accountant.
It also kind of like shows a lot. Like it's like, okay, if you want to just like that quick to brush it off, like it's like, what are we trying to avoid, you know?
And they talked about this. They said, watch in 1 week or a week and a half, there's going to be groundbreaking news in the celebrity world that's going to brush this. Everyone's going to forget about this tomorrow.
Yeah.
And that's what scares me about this whole thing, right? It scares me about the news because I know how quick things get brushed under the rug and the next big thing happens. I think back to the time where North Korea was going to nuke us because... And we were all now Iran is, right? And then like all of the new news comes in and then the old news is gone. It's like this constant state of like sacrificial lambs being thrown in the celebrity world to like.
But I think it also has a lot to do with our accessibility now to modern day technology. I think we're just seeing everything elevated times 1,000 because of how much accessibility and how much propaganda and how much AI is involved.
But do you think it's that though? It's like propaganda and stuff to keep us in a constant state of what's happening next?
Yeah, I mean, think about 20 years ago, I don't think we were this in touch with what's going on to this, which is a good thing because we should be seeing things, you know, but it is very hard to differentiate what's real, what's not, what's biased, what's not.
Like, I do agree with like how quick it comes out. Yeah. Now, because it used to be the next newspaper story.
I think our sources are learning. Everything is now through these platforms versus like news or like books, textbooks. Like we're actually learning through these people are getting their news from TikTok and stuff, which is not the best thing, you know, it's not the best thing.
That's why.
Yeah,
I think that's what people are starting to realize. What they really are supposed to show, they're not showing. But now people all over the world have the ability to post and show.
Well, I was talking to my mom because we were talking about, we were just looking at the videos of, you know, the Palestinian children. And my mom and I were just, we were sitting there sobbing. And she's like, you know, this was happening before you can even imagine. She goes, this type of corruption existed way back. Obviously, she's been through war, all these things like corruption in Afghanistan, all these things. She goes, you guys are just now seeing it because of these cameras. She goes, this has always been the case. And it's so sad, you know, but thank God that we have the ability to now kind of be more woke and informed, you know, granted, with pick and choose wisely with the source that you go with. You know, I think that it is important to do your own research and kind of credibility because there's so much now, so much, but like it's crazy what technology has done.
That's such, because you have it in seconds at your fingertips and you can actually go behind enemy lines and see the corruption and the displacement and everything. It's like, for example, like what your mom said, it's like this has been going on for so long. It happened with the Uyghur Muslims in China till this day. Right now they're in concentration camps and we have no idea what's going on. It was in the news for a couple of days and then it's gone, right? And then the people in Africa that are right now being displaced.
Congo too, yeah.
Yeah, in Congo. And there's tribes that are really going into places in Africa and killing every single person, woman, children, infant. There was, even with the Holocaust and the displacement of Jews back then, you don't think, like, imagine, God forbid, that was to happen today.
Yeah.
That would be crazy, bro. And what Hitler did, bro, like, it's actually psychotic. And that's what makes me so confused about what's happening in Palestine, because I'm saying it's confusing seeing what these people are doing because their people did it.
I know.
We're the people that undergone this.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, let's say, for example, like someone did something so crazy to my family that like was like it changed me as a person and it changed my kid's life. And then I go back and I do the exact same thing.
I know, it's unreal.
That's like confused. Like, how could someone? So that's what I meant by that. You know?
Isn't it also scary to see how much control the media does have with what we can and can't see? Like, if they want to turn it off, because even Meta recently censored so many things. They got like paid off to censor. And even Elon, like, he recently backtracked. You know,
that's why money is the root of all evil. It's all controlled.
That's why
they say money is. And I always thought, like, what does that mean? Does it? Because it does. Like, on a small scale, money makes people do shady to loved ones, friends. They backstab people.
Money's dirty.
I don't understand
it. Big scale of things, this is like money talks.
Money talks.
Throw the key out.
Yeah.
Zip their mouth, throw the key out.
I don't think all of it is about money. I think some people are just stupid and they're oblivious to what they see in front of them and they choose not to show, you know.
Empathy, compassion, humanity.
That's the part that's strange to me. I didn't think we were going to get into this tonight. I'm kind of glad. I want to touch on it lightly. It's literally unbelievable what we're witnessing in front of our eyes and these little devices. And some people can turn away. Some people understand. Some people don't understand. It's a scary time we're living that, you know, because we did hear that this is how it's always been. Yeah. But now to physically see, I've never in my life have seen so much gore in my life. And then for it to be children and then to have people justify that. Absurd to me. I cannot understand it. That's just my part. I don't want to get too much deep into it, you know, but it's just unbelievable.
I just know it makes it so much clearer that there really is a fight with good versus evil. There is really an evil, benevolent force, right? When it comes to everything, right? Like the confusion of like where the world is right now and why like something so clearly obvious is confusing. You know how you guys just like laugh and you're like, it's not confusing, right? Because you're right. Like, but why is it?
But you're and news, I get what you're saying.
Why are they making it such a confusing thing?
Yeah,
why is this, what's proportionate versus disproportionate? This is not even the conversation of proportion and disproportionate. It's like, this is wrong and this is good. That's why I know there's like a devil and there's like evil out there. And I know that like there's all of these things that are corrupting our minds. Like when I go on TikTok, right? When it comes to like even on the smallest scale, right? Like we have kids on TikTok, right? Like our little cousins and stuff. And I'll go and I'll like swipe. And you know how there's sometimes ads that go? I get these ads with like a little video game, right? It's like a little video game of like a girl shooting. And the girl, her body is like... like crazy, like you know the Pixar movies where they have the mom, like where she has like a fucking Coke bottle body? Yeah, like, and it's like shooting and her butt is jiggling and it's like a game, it's a video game where you can click download. And I'm like, bro, how, like this is sexualizing children. And this is like making the world like this very weird, like even for me as a guy that's like 29 years old, right? Like, I know what not to do. I know what to do. I know what to not stray away from, whether it comes to like, and like stuff that really corrupts a guy's mind, right? Because it sexualizes women, right? Like I know to stay away from that because I'm like, this will sexualize pervert people's eyes. And it makes everything like a woman as a sexual symbol, right? And sometimes for people who can't control their vices and stuff, right? This could potentially put them in a weird predicament, right? And it's like, I'm seeing it happen, and it's like almost like grooming children to like feel this way and act like, instead of like promoting our kids to like think of the higher road and like really make them productive people in this world. And I don't want to be, there's this like, remember Will Smith's son, where he talks about, there's this interview of him and he's like, I want to talk about the world tragedy. And it's like super, I don't want to get into like taking the moral high road and stuff, but I can clearly see that there's an agenda, like a clear cut agenda. And in my mind, I'm like, who is pulling the strings on the news? Like you said, the news are paid off. The news are lying. Who is doing this, bro? Who is controlling ads? Who is making, like, I know there's an evil force and a good force, right? And now that I know that, I'm like, all right, which side do I want to align myself with? I'm already on the good side, right? But let me position myself in a way where I'm not letting them control my mind at all.
I think this like whole TikTok implementation from China is some sort of war within itself, where Americans are now being like in the inside so corrupt that our generations of young children are being inside. Like, if I tell you the things my 10-year-old nephew knows, that I couldn't even tell you at 10 years old what I was thinking, the things that I had visibility to, let alone, like, he'll surprise me. And it's not bad, but it's just like, how do you know this, you know? And he's on shorts all day, YouTube shorts.
But it is bad sometimes.
And it is. It's like, at, you know, we spent age, the 20 last 24 hours with him. I'm just like, damn, like, mashallah, part of him, like, damn, you're so grown. But it's also like, you're only 10. And like, it has everything to do with what they're pushing on these social platforms. And it's inevitable to avoid because they're everywhere. And it's like, maybe China does have it all figured out by like blocking all these things. They're not giving accessibility to anybody. Cause it's like, but then here we are as Americans consuming it all. And like, we're on war with ourselves. Like, we are literally in war with ourselves, with people being on one side or the other of things. And it's like, this, all this corruption's coming from these devices that we're seeing that people are probably promoting and shooting from other countries.
Isn't that the most genius way that's to war. Infiltrate someone?
Yeah, we're infiltrate them from decline. The inside. Like, America is in straight decline right
and
now.
It goes and it's to like, show, like you said, with the Chinese and stuff, how they limit like their people from accessing. You don't access even get on
it. Yeah, they don't have anything.
Yeah. I mean, on their TikTok.
No, I don't even know that they have, unless it's, I don't know how it works there, but I don't even know that they have social media like
they
that.
Do.
No,
they do. They have TikTok.
It's limited.
Yeah, I don't know how it works. Kids. I don't know how it works.
Their TikToks it's and different. Their algorithms are
it's not like educational.
And that's so funny because sometimes I'll be on TikTok and I'll get stuff that I'm just like, oh my God, I never, where did this come from? There's no way it's on my, and I'll immediately plus not interested. And it's like, things that will mess your brain up, like it's like disgusting, like whether it's animals, whether it's, you know, like even I was talking to my friends who are like have kids and stuff, and they're like, dude, I can't be on TikTok, like seeing all these kids. And it's like, when you see one thing and you stop for a second, it reads it as that, and then it keeps promoting those videos, and it's like weird, and it's like, dude, it really, really messes with your psyche. So it really I've does seen, turn it all off.
I've seen documentaries and stuff of like Amish people and how they're like still riding in like horse carriages, and they don't have electricity, and they don't believe in any of that. Would you guys be able to like live? And I used to think this is so psychotic. Like, bro, we're in 2023. Bro, hand them an iPhone, and they're gonna tweak out. Have you ever seen those like TikToks? Is like where it would be like me going back to the 1800s era and giving a kid a PS5 and blowing his mind. It's bro, like now I'm starting to understand. Like, although it is a little too extreme, they might have the right idea because it's the most simplistic way of living as a human being that it's possible. But even then you think, okay, so like, poor guy, they have to go through a headache and they don't even have an Advil. Like, you know what I'm saying?
I mean, it's nice because I think Western anything has really gotten too far. And even if like where we were 10 or 20 years ago, I think somebody recently wrote me on Instagram because I posted something about how I felt with everything and it had to do with America. And they were just like, well, if you hate America so much, why don't you leave? And I was like, I don't hate America. I'm here by choice. I'm an American. I identify as Afghan American. And, you know, I was born here. And the thing is that I don't have a problem with America. I have a problem with the choices and the discrepancies and just like the decisions that we have been making as a country in the last maybe 10 years, I think has really hindered our ability as a powerful country to really move forward. And my point with posting those things has a lot to do with just bringing awareness with the hope of seeing improvement one day. But many, well, that's their first case scenario. Like, well, why do you live here? And it's like, well, no, I have, as much as I have my you know, there's aspects that I disagree with. There's so many that I do agree with and love about the country, you know, in comparison to third world countries and foreign countries that are in democracy, all these things. It's like, I do appreciate America, but there's so many things that we can do better that I'm seeing now as I grow older that I've also been a part of in the last 10, 20 years, you know, the impact of social media. And if I could get to a place back in the day where it never existed, I would choose that in a heartbeat. I really would. I would. I think my life would be very different, but it wouldn't be so heavy. Like, no matter whether we think about it or not, it plays a huge, huge role in our psyche.
And that's it what does. People say about like living in, like, I would not be able to do what I'm doing now living in any other country because of capitalism. I believe in it, right? It would let you set yourself up and your family up for success years and years, but there's bad sides of it too. And people argue, well, if you have these problems, Neela, why don't you try to go and become a politician to fix these things? But even then, we know politicians. Well, we have politicians, right? But that's the thing. Like, they are also, it's not even about selling out though, Neela. It's like,
control.
You might not even have the, you might be you limited.
Yeah.
You might, even if you try to become it. Someone, we've that's what I'm it. Saying.
Yeah.
You study your off, right? And you want to go be the governor, right? We had Arnold Schwarzenegger come into being the governor of California. And then what did he do? He didn't do much, right? But it's because there's also limitations. Even if you get, if we train our kids, right, to get off TikTok and learn politics and get to this point, they might get to that point and still not be able to change anything. So who is pulling the strings?
Yeah, who's implementing the policies? The problems are the policies. And
then
the
you do
processes.
Have the sellouts then.
Yeah, yeah.
Right?
That's true. And then you are sell. And it's hard. You're right. Like, we, at the end of the day, they all got a boss. They all do. The governor, the senator, they all do.
Like, even with the Western nations and stuff, why are we not in a point? Okay, if every single day that passes, right, there needs to be like, all right, are we inching towards fixing things, right? Like, even on a state level, right? Or a city level, right? Like, San Francisco, you called me, right? You called me out of nowhere and you're like, Adis, bro, have you been to Oakland? And I was like, what do you mean? You're like, I'm in Oakland right now and I'm like, I'm going to my appointment or something and this place has gotten so bad. Like, the Oakland that I knew and before, even though it wasn't the best, like, there's beautiful parts of Oakland. You have the Lake Merritt, you have everything, right? Like, on a, like, San Francisco, Oakland, the greater area over there, it's gone so much to the ground and, like, literally to a place, it's like apocalyptic weird place where people can't even park their cars. They leave their windows completely down so nobody can go break a window. How is this being enforced, right? Like, do we have enough policing in that area? How are we not sitting down in a city council meeting, right? And then the agenda being like, all right, guys, well, are we getting to a better Oakland or a better San Francisco? What are you talking about? Are you guys talking about residential zoning? Are you guys talking about money? Like,
homeless,
how much
population.
Money is being funded? Homeless people, displacement of homeless people, where they're going to go, how you're going to do it.
Where did Look, they go, though? Recently, there was a cleanup because we had a visit.
Yeah,
our house had to be perfectly clean. All the world
all
leaders.
Of a sudden, every President piece of graffiti, everything.
They admitted
is
it
clean.
Too.
Yeah. And that's what he said.
He's like, yeah, we cleaned this up because I wouldn't lie. Because of you. But it's like, are we not like.
He could have done that. This could have been fixed a long time ago. So now what are they going to, after the guys back home, they're going to dump them back on the street? Well, I don't get it. How
they just
work?
In a car somewhere?
But it's like they but like. If they can do that because these people, and you're going to paint this perfect picture, like, there's 365 days in a year. Am I tweaking?
No.
I've never been good with that. Is it 364?
Yeah. 365.
365, right? So there's 365 days in a year, right? I don't have the answers. I'm not in politics. I cannot tell you what you need to do. But I'm also not a rocket. Don't need to be a rocket scientist to understand that there could be ways where we inch towards fixing things if it's not corrupted from the foundation level all the way up, right? Like, it's like a pyramid. If the foundation is broken, it's going to be banged up at the top too, right? Like, it goes this way, whatever
but
way.
But I also believe it trickles down, actually. If you think of it from a pyramid perspective, it's the top of the pyramid that's not cascading down correctly,
yeah.
Which is why everybody beneath it has nothing to follow through with.
Exactly.
Yeah, so
it
has
whatever,
everything
you flip
to do
it,
with leadership.
Right?
Yeah.
But it's like, what are they focusing on, bro? Is it bread?
That's what I'm saying.
Is it paisa, bro? Like, are we fighting over money here? Or, like, why is our cities going to shit? Bro,
why are we still
paying taxes? Because I'm not going to.
And bro, you know what the funniest part
about
that?
A long time you haven't.
The funniest
pay your
part,
taxes,
bro. The funniest part
like
about
I'm I'm not paying taxes. I'm not.
Bro, no, we're all paying taxes.
Student loans.
No, we're all paying taxes. I know, I am. You don't want to fight Uncle Sam, my guy.
Who is he? Where does he?
Uncle Sam.
Bro, but that's what I'm saying. So you're paying, you're telling me, right, that you're taxing me every single day, and then when, so I get money, right? My money is being taxed, right? I get a salary, that's getting taxed, right? And then when I go buy things at the store, you're also taxing that. So you're taxing the money that I'm making, and then you're taxing the things that I'm buying.
What,
you're
double whamming me. Yeah, it doesn't make sense.
And then on top of that, where I live, in the city that I live in, is garbage. Yeah. San Francisco is the richest city in the, one of the richest cities in the world, and it's garbage, yo.
Yeah.
Yes. Where are we going with this?
Nowhere.
Well, it's going to the Middle East. That's where our money's going.
And then I see those headlines, bruh. $49 billion going to Israel.
That's wild.
$79 million.
What's the
billion,
there?
100 trillion. What is that? $1 billion, bro?
No, they don't need that. They don't need that. But it's they like, don't even need that. They have money.
But what is that? Is what is the motivation
behind it?
I saw this TikTok.
It has
the girl
to be just
said,
numbers, I think.
She asked.
And Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Is that what it is?
No. It's like, oh, like what is $1 billion to them? Is it like, okay, how do you compute that? Yeah. How are you sending it? I get it. It's in weapons. It's whatever. But it's like, okay, where is that billions of dollars going? And we're on a super deficit and we owe China trillions of dollars.
It's going
and,
to Tel Aviv.
Brother, like, what are we doing?
So much partying.
I feel like it's so overcomplicated, just like the news is overcomplicated, right? And they're like confusing things with us and throwing this at us and then this at us. I wish they're just like, put like 20 dudes that just chief all day, put them in position,
put them
in the House of Representatives, bro, and they just be like this. They smoke, they burn one, they'd be like, hey, why is that money going that way, bro? Hey, let's just put $2 billion into San Francisco real quick, New York. They got a homeless pop. Hey, just put $2 billion over there. Hey, fuck them, like straight up. Hey, they don't need that, but send them 200,000 real quick. And then that's it.
Put Addis in that conversation.
Bro, I swear to God, they're overcomplicated on purpose. They keep you at a state of confusion on purpose,
yeah,
bro.
They
gotta just be like this. Put some regular degler dudes, bro, that just work some regular
street
degler.
Street smart,
bro. To put two, that's why they hated Donald Trump. He was a street smart. He was divisive by the way he talked, which is really bad. But I feel like, bro, if you put a couple of business guys that are just like, that don't make sense, dude.
You know what they need to put in there? The head of HOAs.
They get done.
Put the head of HOA in those meetings.
They get
Let me
done.
Tell you, they'll take some money out of you to fix the property, allegedly.
Yeah.
We don't know where the money's
They're
going.
They're frauding.
In-house.
But that's what I'm saying, bro. Take these overcome, you know, like politicians, they talk, they get, there's an answer that's, what's 3 + 3, bro? And they give you, well, that's going to come down to how you're computing it. Through Almahaic geometry, you're going to get several different.
Very robots.
No, brother, like, robots. It's very simple, bro. I really think it's like, in the grand scheme of things, when it comes to several different things, like, it's like when you're getting fired from a job, right? Addis, please come to my office, okay? And then, like, let me just give you a scenario, right? And you just want the clear cut, like, bro, why are you launching me, right? Yeah. But, like, I've had to fire people when I was working in finance, right? And it was very difficult. You've had to fire a lot of people, right? And, like, from your bosses, they tell you how to go about it. Like, you're going, and then the poor guy sitting there, like, so why are you firing me? And you're like, you know, this is the very difficult conversation. And you have to give them several different ways to go about the conversation when, in general, probably your sucks.
Yeah.
Your numbers are not there. Get them hired, because if you go to another job, it's not going to cut it, right?
Yeah.
But they give you 17 different ways. And at the end of it, you're like, am I fired or am I coming to work tomorrow?
Yeah.
Bro, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's what they do on a higher level. They keep everyone so confused.
I can picture you,
bro,
firing someone. And that's exactly how it would go.
It's very hard. I'd be like, brother, it's not you, it's me. And then I'm going to I'm gonna give him my resignation myself. I'm be like, sign here, bro. I'm quitting. I'm quitting with you. Bro, but that's the thing about the world, bro. It shouldn't be that difficult, bro. If you figured it out, in 24 hours, bruh, how to clean up the streets for President Xi, You're telling me in 365 days, bruh, you can't figure out to make the homeless population in the homeless being all over the streets.
They don't want to allocate their money, their budget, their resources into something that they think that it won't end. They think that it'll be pointless because it'll just come back, I think, and which is dumb because it's like it only comes back because people don't know any better. But if you implement processes and procedures where people feel like they have a ground to walk on and a voice to be heard, maybe they'll get a different outcome.
And I'm not, okay.
They're set in stone on what's always been the way. But it's like change is welcome too. You have to put in then.
Big on Sharia law, right? Like in Middle East, like when you chop somebody's arm off. But like Dubai, right? They have a very, and I haven't been there, but from what I've heard, they have a very clean system, right? Nobody steals in Dubai, bro. It's one of the safest places in the world to go to. You can leave your car, your Rolls Royce, open on the street with the key in the ignition, with your cell phone and 50 grand in the seat. No one will touch it, right? It's advanced. It has everything. Again, and I don't know how these sheikhs and they be getting down weird on the low. Okay, I don't know. But again, they have a system that they made because Dubai is relatively new in the grand scheme of things. They created it like...
It recently came about.
But they figured out a way to make it the most advanced, the most nice, the most safest city, right? Isn't that the same thing that we should push in the world, especially Western society that's the land of opportunity, the land of the free? This place should look like Dubai, bro. I swear to God, should it not?
Yeah.
You should give people opportunities
to grow. Many will argue it's the people. Many will argue that it has everything to do with the people. Our people are not equipped to live a Dubai lifestyle.
But
who got us to that point?
Yeah, but then also we have open borders that some people kind of, they put. And again, like if you go to places like Abu Dhabi and you go to Saudi Arabia, like someone that's not an Arab in those countries cannot go and open because like one of my, Sarah's cousins, Mansoor, he came from Saudi Arabia, right? And he's a smart guy, business savvy. He opened up a business here, right? Didn't know the English language, learned the English language, opened up his own restaurant, is doing amazing, opening up another restaurant. He's my age, if not younger than me, right? Like smart guy, right? But in Dubai, in Saudi Arabia, where his whole family was, where they immigrated, I don't know, from Afghanistan or wherever, he couldn't go and just open up a business, right? He had to be an Arab by blood or lineage, right? So he had to trust another Arab to open up a business. And then some people can get over it. So it's like,
I think discipline to an extent. Like, no, I think it's a form of discipline though. Like I don't agree with Sharia law. Don't chop someone's hands off if they steal, which in Afghanistan is what happens, right? That's their way of governing. But and I think that's the cost that comes with the free world here, like America, is that there is a lot of getaway. There's a lot of freedom to do essentially corruption and criminal behavior because you can get away with it, which many, again, to play devil's advocate on the political side, will argue, why would we put forth our efforts to better something if the people will continue to act in this behavior? But then it's like, well, we implemented this open freedom right to begin with, which allows them to feel like they can perform in that behavior, go, you know, vandalize stores and all these things and freedom of protest, all those things. Yes. But it's like, are we putting the behavior, you know, in front of people who are like, okay, you're worth me fixing your city. You know, it's like, I get it. I'm agreeing. Fix the city. Give them the opportunity to be better. But it's also like, well, we're a free world. They can do what they want, essentially. They can go stealing. Right now, everyone's stealing and no one is getting any type of, you know, reprimand for it. It's like, you're stealing, you get away with it. It's fine. That's all across America. So it's like, it's kind of like, you know, the blind leading the blind.
The foundation is corrupt.
That's what I'm saying. Like from the top down, it's corrupt. Like processes and policies are the problem. That's the problem. And no one's willing to revisit it, you know, because there's too much to look into. It's too deep.
And I really don't have an answer, bro. Aside from getting my homies to just go into the House of Rev and go into Congress and make some happen, bro. Like, I don't know. Because again, like, you're not going to be the type of people that go into like a Saudi. And if you do steal in Saudi, you're getting your arm chopped off. Like, bro, we can't do
but
that.
But sometimes,
here.
Maybe
like,
that type of discipline, not agreeing
we'll
with
scare
it.
Scare somebody that's into a type not doing
that's needed in certain places, bro. Because then why are those countries that no one's stealing $50,000 in a car that's wide open? Like, maybe you got to put fear into someone. I got my growing up, which is why I didn't do anything I wasn't supposed to do. And here I am following rules.
I got that's so discipline. Funny that you bring that. Yeah. Like discipline. I got asked that question. Like, would you ever discipline your children? And my answer is probably not. Like, I don't believe you have to beat your kids
not I mean, beat. But, I mean, don't get, we didn't get
no,
beat.
No, I know, like slap, like a little whatever, like, you know, but.
You have to instill some sort of fear, yeah, or else they won't fear you.
That's what I'm saying, but you also see as some kids
say that now,
twack out, bruh.
You're going to want to smack your little kid every now and then because they are bad. Yeah, they are so bad.
Especially these little kids nowadays.
Yeah, that's
I
love what I'm
them. Like, I personally wouldn't. But then I think I would.
No, no, I've gotten spanked. I've gotten spanked growing up. And, like, not even, like, for me, it was harder to get, like, the silent treatment or, like, the lectures along, the screaming. Like, and it's not in a sense where I'm trauma. I think my parents did an amazing job raising us, right? Yeah. Money? Like, I don't have anything bad to say about the way I was. And it wasn't always. It was, like, if you really, 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 really mess up. It wasn't if I even brought home bad
Speak
grades.
For yourself.
It's like, if you really messed up. Well, you really messed up.
Okay. I did. I was a black sheep.
No, okay. But I'm saying, like, if we really did something bad, we would definitely feel the repercussions of it. But, and that's what instilled that fear, that respect, that moral in us. And I think is necessary.
No, I agree.
To draw that foundation.
I've seen people wild out when they don't have, like, I had friends growing up, like one of my two really close friends in high school, and their parents, well, their dad, they lived with their dad at the time. I love them. They're amazing people. I don't know where they are now, but they're my best friends, right? And their dad let them do whatever, like whatever they wanted. Like, it didn't matter. Like, the dad supplied them with weed and, like, alcohol and, like, whatever they wanted, they were able to do. And then that led them to a path where now there were repercussions that came from it, right? They had too much leniency that now there are rules and regulations in life, bro. You can't just go do what you want to do, or else, like, it would be literally, like, chaos, right? Yeah. And then they didn't live with a fine line of, like, guidance and a rule set, and now they did whatever they want that led them down a bad path where they're doing bad things, right?
And that's
so
how it happens in the foundation of the world too. It's like the country allows you to get away with X, Y, and Z. You're gonna develop that behavior ongoing. You're gonna get away with it, and it's like, okay, what does that lead to? That results into cities, and, you know, I mean, but it's also kind of like it's designed that way too, to keep things the way they are. They don't want to help because they need that. Also, it's weird. It's annoying. It doesn't make sense.
That's why guidance and. Like, I want to get your guys' opinion on how to properly guide someone, right? Because, like, our parents did their best that they could possibly, within their means, right, to make us understand what life was about, like, right? Like, the realities that come to life. You have to work hard. There's nobody kind of, you know, at the end of the day, like, you can boof yourself by not, yeah. You know, being a moral, you know, that person of high integrity. And, like, we learn also. We're creatures of habit and people who, like, absorb. We're like sponges and we absorb. Like, if our parents, like, and I've learned this with, like, people that I know, right? Like, if your parents are banged up, right, and they do wrong to people and they do trifling shit, or they do shiesty people, the kids are probably going to be poo shiesty. And yeah. Like that, right? And that's why it's so crazy to understand, like, how are you going to lead by example when it comes to kids and when it comes to friends and family? Like, are you guys, I'm a little nervous because I don't want to be, and I know, like, I'm going to be, like, the best dad, inshallah, one day, right? Because, like, I'm very comfortable knowing that I'm a good enough person to raise a good enough kid, right? But then again, you have the outlier of, like, they're their own person. You never know if you have a bad kid, you feel me? But it's like, are you guys nervous of, like, like, even with Cam and Rowan, and, like, they're absorbing everything from their parents, from their aunts, which is you guys, right? Like, when you guys, like, are around them and stuff, do you guys have that notion, like, they're absorbing everything I'm telling them right now? Do you feel, because I don't know what it feels like to have a nephew or a niece, you know what I'm saying? I have little cousins, but I only see them, like, here and there, right? Do you guys see them picking up on small little things that you say? Like, you know, as small as, like, when we would laugh when one of our little cousins would say a F word or something. Yeah. Where'd they get that from? Definitely Adis or Billy or what? You feel me? Like, we would say something and, like, they would regurgitate that and we're just like, oh, do you ever see that, like, them coming up with, like, certain things, like small little things that you would say or how you would act? Do you see that in them?
Not us, but I see their parents in them, absolutely. And I see, like, things that they, for example, Cameron, what he watches on Shorts or TikTok or whatever, I see those habits, and it amazes me because I'm like, how?
Because this how? Little human is going to grow up and be a person.
Oh no, they're bad. You they're know? Already they're grown bad, and they're bad.
Yeah, no, like generation. Kids, you just learn and you start, this little being is potentially going to affect all of these other people in their lives' life, whether it be a relationship or a girlfriend, they're going to affect that girl, or they're going to affect their workplace, whether it be good or bad. And I know because their parents are amazing people that they're going to be good. But imagine if you see a person, and it makes sense, when you have an evil person out there and you start to trace back like their family history, the trauma that they went through, and it makes total sense why they're the way they are. You know? And it's so fascinating to see that. A lot of people have kids and it's they don't think I need to raise this little kid into being a grown man who's gonna affect tens of hundreds of people in their life.
Right.
That's insane to me. That's why it's so important to know, like, yeah, everyone wants to have kids.
And partner. You got to understand who you want to have kids with.
Exactly.
Like, you could do everything
right.
And
it's selfish,
the philosophy behind parenting needs to be discussed because that plays a big role. You can grow up and do everything and to be taught right, and you have came from a very healthy, happy household, and you know all the right things to implement and what you believe is right. And then you have someone who's the complete opposite. And I see this in relationships, and their parenting styles very much conflict. And it's like, well, now this poor child is in the middle of it, and they have to learn kind of based off of what they're getting from both parents, how to kind of navigate their own life. And then they get to a peak where they can make their own decisions, and they're just like screwed because they're like, well, how do I know what's right or wrong? You know, like what I've been taught two different things. It's like, I think a lot of, and I say this as someone who wants to have kids one day, God willing, I am very, very anxious about what that looks like. And for myself, I wonder, like, am I ready to bring a life? And I was talking to Tam about this. She just recently had a baby. And I was like, isn't it so scary to think about how you're, like what you're teaching this little sponge to like grow up and like learn, and like that's going to be everything you've given them, because everything I am is from my parents, and that, and all the my goods and all my habits, even my bad habits sometimes, I'm like, that's all implemented through, you know, my parents. And I'm like, to teach another child, am I ready for that? Do I have what it takes to grow someone to be a good person? And I know I will one day, but it's like, it's a very scary weight to carry.
And that's why I'm like, it could be so selfish. A lot of people, they want kids to just have it's like an accessory, or they want to have kids because they're getting older. And bro, like, it's hella selfish to even raise that kid, not putting him in the best scenario. And people will chalk it up to, there's never going to be a perfect time. There's never going to, but at least try to mentally get to the place where it is in your best interest and that little baby's best interest to raise them and grow them to be this like successful person that can take on the world, because it's not their kind of fault they're, you know, brought up and born. You feel me? Yeah. Like, it was your decision, bro, to, you know, partake in that activity to, you know, have a kid, right? So it's like, bro, now I'm starting to realize the weight of it. And these people are the people that are going to be the next generations.
Yeah.
The people that lead life. And it's fascinating to me.
Yeah. Like, can you imagine how they brought up Joe Biden? Like, what would they clearly f*** him up? The man can't differentiate compassion from empathy or just logic. So it all has to do with his.
And he's a world leader. God. You feel me? The state of the world is insanity.
That's wild, man. Who have you?
To each their own, I guess.
Wow.
And I guess we will leave it there. Mojo, I love you so much. We did majority of the talking today. I'm so sorry.
No, it's okay. I just, normally I'm behind the scene. Today I'm just here. I get to look at you guys talk.
We love you so much, Mojo. Love Thank you for showing up. Niels, where can they find us?
YouTube.com/TheDemoPodcast. TDP.
We out.
We out.